on this particular topic, which is the living with bipolar, and maybe sir, 20-25 minutes you could just have on that particular topic, and if you need more time, that's also okay, sir. And then what we would basically want is then ma'am can share her views, or you can, and then we can have a round of question and answers.
No. Pratik, can I intervene? Parikshit, let it start with Monica. We always start with the person who's suffering.
Take care. That's all.
Because then Dr. Sudhakar will get the point.
Because like what she is trying to cover, I will get some directions for my talk.
That's fine. We can have it done. That way only we'll do it then. We'll have Monica ma'am first then, and then we'll have sir. And then of course lots of questions are normally always there. So we will just follow up with that. So I'll just invite Monica ma'am to share her views, and then it's a very good morning, and you know it's also Valentine's Day, and you know I don't know what weather is like in Assam, but Delhi is just becoming a little bit warm now. So you know it's a good idea to talk about mental health on Valentine's Day to convey that you know you can really have a normal life even if you have any kind of mental health issue. So with these words, Monica ma'am, I'd invite you to please take the stage.
Okay, right. Thank you, Dr. Parikshit. Very good morning to all of you who are joined on this warm Sunday morning. Thank you for finding time. Before I start with my story, I must take this opportunity to thank Archana madam for starting this kind of a movement and also for inviting me to be a part of this movement. We call ourselves the Proud Depressors. That's up to you, ma'am, for thinking of such a thing, sitting at your position. It means a lot to all of us and people like us. So, the Proud Depressive has a page on Facebook, as most of you know. I will start with a small, you know, description of bipolar mind. I thought it was wonderful and it was so apt. I think it was shared by Lisa, ma'am, a couple of days ago. It says, you are either too happy, too sad, or you just don't care. Finding the feelings in the middle do not come naturally. You have to fight every day to find them. While I was struggling with this, I can totally relate with this kind of mental situation. So, just so that you get a proper perspective of what it could be, how it could fit me. I would like to briefly describe myself as a school girl and as a college girl. I studied in Notre Dame Academy, as some of the members who have joined here have studied so. There I was in love with academics. The things which were in syllabus. I used to do a couple of my sessions every year. I also remember that those days we used to get a certificate for, you know, the highest scorer in every section, the highest scorer in all the three sections. So I did it year after year, and I took it to my father, who really inspired me to, you know, study harder and do better. He said, this you do every year, why not do it in all three sections? So next year I studied extra, I went ahead and topped in all three sections. I was but an introvert, although I used to be the class rep and the topper of the class and sometimes the best citizen also, still I was an introvert. There was a lot of, you know, a sense of prestige, popularity, propriety. Kabhi bhi mujhe daat nahi mila, mujhe yaad nahi ki kabhi my parents would have scolded me or even the teachers. I was the favorite everywhere. From there on, I think my dedication towards academics and my love for academics took me, sailing through graduation in Rana House in physics and post-graduation. And civil services also, which I always dreamt to, sit for this examination and appear in the list. So I got through civil services also. There was no stress in all these years till I actually got through NABARD for civil services later. There was no stress because studies was my comfort zone. जितना भी चैलेंज करो आई स्टडी ऑल दोस टेक्स्ट बुक्स आई वाज आई यूज्ड टू स्लीप विद दोस टेक्स्ट बुक्स माय सिस्टर यूज्ड टू गेट इरिटेटेड कम से कम उसको अलग बॉडी यूज टू टेल यू हाउ टू स्लीप आल्सो इंक्लूडेड इन दिस सेशन सो शी यूज्ड टू टेल मी कम से कम किताब को अलग करते वो भी नहीं करते सो दैट वॉज द लव आई हैड फॉर बुक्स फॉर टेक्स्ट बुक्स नॉट यू नो आउट ऑफ सिलेबस सो टू ईयर्स बैक I got my first posting in Indian Railway Services. I got to Indian Railway Postal Service. I was posted at Ratlam. Ratlam now is a small town. It is known only for its government presence. You know, the collectorate would be there or not there. I don't even know. But the railway had a huge presence in Ratlam. Initially, I felt lonely and I felt struggling doing those files. I was called assistant personnel officer, bills. So there were huge, you know, vouchers to sign and files, dirty files. I could not, you know, get myself to enjoy my work. It took time. So I thought it was just that, you know, my initial difficulty in understanding and comprehending my work. But it was something else which I came to know later. Within 2 months, I recovered on my own. But I didn't even know it was a condition, but I started feeling better. But this time, there was a surge of energy, which was quite unlike myself. I was meeting people, I was talking to people, I was going out of my way to meet, you know, officers and families, new colleagues, and I thought, oh, it was a chair, I like myself. Like this. So I started enjoying myself. But the condition was there. So it came back. The depression episode came back. And this time it was worse than the last time. Because obviously I didn't consult any doctor. I never felt any need for that. This time you just imagine that from Patna I have gone to Ratlam. Ratlam is only railways and government. And then on top of that, there is no other officer of my age group, you know, no other direct officer in any department. So, अगर मुझे problem लग रही है तो मुझे नहीं पता किससे बात करनी है. So I was properly clinically depressed. I would not step out of the rest house. And I'm sure people in office were puzzled because they have seen the the manic person. So they would send the files to the rest house. तो मैं कर देती थी जहाँ बोलते थे यहाँ साइन कर लो वहाँ साइन कर लो सब किया बिना विदाउट कॉम्प्रिहेंडिंग व्हाट एग्जैक्टली बॉडी बट दिस वेंट ऑन फॉर टू लॉन्ग फॉर एवरीबॉडीज कंफर्ट एंड आई थिंक समबडी कॉल्ड होम इन पटना दैट डे ट्रैवलिंग दोस डेज ट्रैवलिंग वॉज नॉट ईजी यू नो इवन दो आई वॉज इन रेलवे ट्रैवलिंग ऑन रेल वॉज नॉट ईजी फॉर पेरेंट्स who were both already 60 plus. But somebody called home, I don't know what they said. They, both of them arrived in an emergency. I was happy to see them, but I could not express it properly. They stayed with me for 2 days. The highest officer of the divisional office is called the DRM. We called them for a cup of tea and I was also there. They said, इसको ले जाइए पटना अपना डॉक्टर से इलाज करवाइए डोंट वरी अबाउट द लीक वी विल मैनेज एवरीथिंग एंड कम बैक ओनली व्हेन शी इज फाइन बिकॉज वी हैव सीन शी इज यू नो बंडल ऑफ एनर्जी एंड ऑल दैट दे हैव सीन एवरीबॉडी हैज सीन ना द बंडल ऑफ एनर्जी सो दे कैन सी द कंट्रास्ट सो आई वाज टेकन बैक टू पटना एंड दोस डेज आई डोंट नो वेदर देयर वाज एनी साइकियाट्रिस्ट इन पटना और नॉट But I was taken to the best physicians. I don't even remember going to a neurologist and because everybody was puzzled. You know, the parents ko pata nahi isko hua kya hai. I think everybody was in some sort of denial. Ye kyun isko nahi ho sakta. It's just a temporary thing. Akeli wahan rehti hai, shayad iske karan ho gaya. Still I could go to the doctor. So 15 din mein medicine badalte. They change the doctor, change the medicine. ओके ये दिस इज नॉट वेरिंग एनी इफेक्ट चेंज द डॉक्टर चेंज द मेडिसिन और इसी बीच आई गॉट माय ऑर्डर्स ऑफ ट्रांसफर फ्रॉम हाउ टू से वेस्टर्न रेलवे टू ईस्टर्न रेलवे all these new zones were coming up.
Mm-hmm.
So they wanted officers, you know, and particularly those officers who belonged to that area. And my father had also chased it. I did not know the room, but he was chasing it, his going the Mantri Petru, and he did something. And I got his order, and suddenly I was very happy once again. I used to take medicine only when I was depressed. Tab main sabhi sunti thi. Jab theek ho jati thi, then I said, this is me. This is what I am. This is how a railway officer should be. So, abhi tak wo proper diagnosis nahi ho. Pure 4 years and very, you know, eventful years of my life went on in proper diagnosis, incorrect, you could say, whatever. Didn't approach doctors at the right time. So I got better, and there was another 2-3 months of normal or manic behavior. I didn't hurt anybody in this period, but I remember being very, very restless. Matlab Hajipur is like 20 kilometers away from Patna. I was staying with my parents. मतलब लंच करने के बाद 4 बजे से लगने लगता था कि मुझे अब घर जाना चाहिए. So I have to do something which I want. I don't want to be here. And it affected, you know, my reputation also, I'm sure it did. And these 4 years were, well, everybody was trying to lay foundation, you know, on how to understand work, how to go about work. I was here struggling with different forms of me. So my father saw, thought ki, me and my sister also got married, and the sister. My parents thought he was going to marry her. It was an arranged marriage. I got married. And again, all the I was just before marriage, my mood reached such a low. I was thinking that the mind is active all the time. Whether you are depressed or in manic phase, it is active all the time. Except that in manic phase, you should. Whatever you think, you carry on it. So, my father was very, very sick at that time. He was recovering from TB, and all the relatives told him he had to shadi kare. And it was almost finalized, but I felt very guilty, you know, to put my parents in that situation, that they should think in my liability and I should be married. I also thought of ending my life, and I worked on it. I will not give the details, but I did something. Okay. And that was the worst, you know, in a way. I thought at that time that was the worst, that was to come later and realize. But my mother was very upset. And I was sick. I got married, and there was a lot of expectation, you know, anticipation of the shadi earlier, and you were pampered also. And he was again better. I tried to tell my husband that there is a problem, and I was on medication. So, because I was blabbering all the time, they did not take me seriously, because I was the manic person who got married. They did not take me seriously. It was good, it suited me. I hated people, you know, they used to talk behind my back. But soon enough, before even we celebrated our first anniversary, another few months of depression. Now you must be thinking, but the moment I started feeling low, I stopped going up to office. In a job like this, you know, since railway service is a high pressure job, and that too, where you have an interface of people with a lot of staff, a lot of people coming and going within the office. So I used to just stop going to office. Everybody was coming. Earlier it was only the parents who were present. Now it was my in-laws' family also was puzzled, and who had seen my money place, and used to think some. I don't know what to do, seriously. But I'm sure they put them in a very difficult situation. There must be, probably there was, because my husband is a very quiet and gentle, and you know, that kind of person. Itna dhoop pe ghai is pe ko, ye aisi nahi thi. I'm sure aisa sochte. But depression was sick, and this one was like 4 months, 5 months. We were really going to office, and I rolled up in a room. And when I'm also the newlywed in a colony. I mean, never lived in a colony, by the way. I wanted to mention this. तो पीपल वुड कम टू मीट मी एंड आई यूज्ड टू थिंक ओह ये जरूर देखे आए हैं, ये अफसर है और ये ऐसे भी है, तो वो मुझे लग रहा था सबको ठीक मिल गया है, बट इट वॉज लाइक दैट एंड देन अराउंड दैट टाइम I also discovered I was expecting a child, and I had just started to think, and some neurologists had said that this is classic case of bipolar disorder, lithium is the only medicine that will be of any help. I just started, and I was thinking that it will be cheap, it will be bimari, it will be cheap. And then I had to stop the medication because it was a child. And those 7-8 months, I was very happy with it for them. And the moment the delivery happened, which was a cesarean, there was another depression, you know, postpartum, whatever fancy name it has. It was so terrible, matlab, I used to just tear up my child. I didn't know what to do. This poor Mahana Kase, this Solana Kase, all stressed up. But I was looking so forward to this, this episode of this moment of my life. But I don't know why I hated God. Matlab, aise samay mein mujhe aisa kar diya. Maine ke rakhte to shayad main exam de deti. But for 6 months, for the first time, this time, because some doctors, you know, I think the gynecologist said you might have to terminate the pregnancy because you certain pregnancy. So he went to AIIMS for the first time into 2004. There, all the doctors, you know, they discussed a lot. I need a psychiatrist. The psychiatrist still said today, even if it was for 2 months, we all would be happy to terminate. But thankfully for all of us, we went ahead with the pregnancy, and I had to go to AIIMS 2-3 times for future report. They said, heart failure, heart failure. It was all good, but the postpartum medication was waiting for me. And I would get that in 6 months. I was on senior child care leave, but my husband was staying at all the nights. You know, while he was still working, he was in BSNL department, he was a civil engineer from my department, very sober person, he knew other than what went on in his mind, but he did it. Modern way he used to go to water, and he likes his to stay there. So after the son was 5-6 months old, I went to the place, I met up each other, and he started doing the education. Medication had a good effect on me. My life was good. For 3 years, I entered office. Entered office was a big thing, continuously. Maybe there was a couple of episodes.
Monica, can you be a little louder, please? Because there's a train going behind you, so there's a lot of disturbance.
Okay, so for 3 years I was, you know, I was on proper medication. I used to go to doctor every time there was a situation. I could, I knew where to go, where to get it. And my professional life stabilized. My personal life also, you know, I was happy with the way things were. But in 2009. My husband got transferred to Delhi. He chose to come to BMRC or Depression. And I chose to stay on in Patna because my son was so young, just 4 years old. And I lost my father in 2009. Now, it was a huge setback, but there was mourning, there was grief, but there was no depression. So, you know, it emboldened me. I can go without medicines. Once again. And then we were also thinking we second child tablet. It was like planning TV. We didn't put the doctors are trying to do. And he wrote the prescription. So take one of medicine and you see a local doctor in Patna. But these 3 years were not good for me, agonized. There was a depression of 2 months. But the Bharat Sarkar had introduced this child care leave, so it helped me that way. and I thought I can still balance. In 2010, in this, now I can see as hindsight, you know, how I was in my manic phase. I remember once I had a bank balance of 42,000, okay, 42,000 in huge money in 2010. I was angry, you know, with something that was going around. I had to vent it out. I mean, the best way to do was retail therapy for me. 42,000, I said 38,000, I have get out of India. I was saying alone with my son. बहुत सारे एक्सपेंसेस होते हैं बट डराव के लिए अंदर दैट डराव आई एम वेयरिंग दिस पोस्टर आई हेटेड दैट डराव लेटर ऑन बट आई एम वेयरिंग इन दिस पोस्टर सो दिस वाज हाउ आई वाज आई एम कंट्रोल एक्चुअली यू आर नॉट इन दिस स्टार्ट ऑफ द वेरी नाइस थिंग इन योर लाइफ बट आई वाज दिस आई वाज नो आई एम गुड आई एम हैप्पी दिस इज हाउ एन ऑफिसर शुड बी दिस हाउ माय मदर शुड बी एंड आई डोंट केयर अबाउट पीपल हु डोंट So 2010-11, no, my husband, 11, my husband was visiting Patna and my mother came to my house only to tell me to get up dawa shuru karo, dawa shuru karo. I said, why are you interfering with my life? Just imagine me in my school days and I'm talking like this to my mother, you know, 2000, I just said it goodbye. It was a 12 I would be happy to, you know, join my husband and work my pastor on this company, whatever they do. Because in 12 years, thank God, you know, what a schedule. Yeah. Just imagine, you have a pastor to replace. You have done all the good work those 3 years and people around you know, you can work. And now, I'm pastor to Delhi and I have again downward depression. 7-8 months. It was like spurts of manic behavior of 1 or 2 or 3 weeks followed by months of depression. So Delhi office people had all their ideas, people talk a lot. People love to talk. Especially if there's a downfall like this. 2012, I think I made life going for everybody. Once my sister ji, very elderly person, Delhi and about my father. He was visiting Delhi for his treatment. Around that time I was having huge fights with my mother. And I told him, because you are here, he's not paying attention to me. Get rid of the treatment part was over, of course. So I told him to go back. And just a few days later, when my mother came, that was the manic phase, And my mother came and I told her to get up and ask her. So, my mother could see me in the state I was in. She was not very stable. She said, please go to Ramil Mahi. But I just couldn't get over it. When I said, I see that you were 70 years old, maybe approaching 80. I did that. Even at 2 o'clock in the night, I told my husband, see, I'm not well, you just get me sometimes to some hospital and I stay there. At 2 o'clock in the night, I drove to the house and they said, please go to hospitalization. We came back to court and with some rest, I was okay. I don't know why I was feeling so restless. Then, because hospitalization did not happen on that day, I held a grudge. So after a few days, I got myself hospitalized in Max emergency. Emergency charges a lot, as you all know. And they made a bill of 25,000. And there was no need, I'm sure there was no need to have a rest or anything. Well, I wouldn't think of anything, just myself. I think I know really neglecting my child also around that time. So my mother visited me 2 or 3 times in 2012 and unfortunately I lost her also. After so many things that have happened, you know, to disturb me and everybody around, I decided to make a few promises to myself. One of them was, if I feel low, I will not stop doing that. My mother used to say, unless and until you are accomplished, how will you know whether you can handle it or not? I said, help me forever. Never help you. Then I also promised myself that I will focus on work and my family. So I narrowed down my social activities. And there were episodes, and the doctor was very accessible because I was in Delhi. And there were episodes of depression. But I think the manic phase had stabilized a little. In 2016, I was transferred to Moradabad to work as a technical person. You are the departmental head in that office. I resisted that order. I refused to carry out that order with all my might, telling them, you are exposing me, feeling how I will be able to work. But still, I have to carry out. Sometimes it is like that, it's a very good job. And I stayed there for 1.5 years, and I just managed. I was not a good start. But I could learn. Even with depression in 2 weeks, these days depression could happen only for 2 weeks or so, I don't know how. But the duration had narrowed down. I will not go with any more episodes, but episodes continued 2 years ago. And
no, Monica ma'am, I think you are doing fantastic, so please continue. I mean, we are not, I mean, you know, we are learning a lot, so in the whole process, so please continue.
Okay. So, a lot of things in railways and in as well in the country are streamlined. Like even if you are depressed, you are still functional because things come to you. You are in a position where work you are having to work gets done even without your regular intervention sometimes. Because you build systems like that, you know, systems of monitoring and other things. So, Moradabad was a good experience. That was the listening, and I don't hold a grudge, and I'm thankful for that experience. But when I came back to Delhi, I was on medication, but I was very unhappy. The episodes of depression still was coming back to me. So, what I wanted to know that with meditation, now I am in a position that in the last 2 years there has been no depth of depression, and in the last 3 years there have been no manic episode either. Within Delhi, after coming back from Moradabad, I got tested in railway office, in this number of offices. I didn't know what to do. Just joined. Other places people told me. This was a place that I had come at a high level and people told me. So the boss and everybody in the office, they used to call up. Sometimes I took those calls, sometimes I didn't. So I thought of writing exactly what was my problem. I wrote a short message to my boss. You see, I had been a patient of bipolar disorder. I'm currently doing this course. I'm in touch with my doctor. The doctor has been sending me a message. And I don't know how much longer it will take, but I cannot come to office. Later on, when I joined, and when I was okay, and I was doing the files, I did it for 3 months only. I saw that the same language was written in a note. My boss had put up the matter to the higher authority, who was member staff inside. The member staff to Vichwaya, various couples, the same language, yeah, which is what I have equated in my sense. So for this period, this work should be looked after by so and so. So I was happy that it came into the file, and I was very comfortable that people now know that I have this problem and I can still do the work. To end my discussion, I will just say a few words. My niece in Seattle said before me that you must have some quotes also. So I will end with that quote, which most of you have heard. I'm sure. Life isn't about waiting for the storm to pass, it's about learning to dance in the rain. So I'm simply dancing in the rain. I have been not going to check medicine. I'm not going to check medicine for a meeting. I have to take care of my son in the standard. I think he knows, I think he has a word of heart, but he's okay. This generation doesn't judge me. I like people who don't judge me. I have a pet for the last 2 years. I don't know how the pet has helped them. I would also like to mention that the trigger was not a huge thing always. As I mentioned, when I lost my father, there was no depression. When I lost my mother, I was already in depression. But there was no feeling that much of remorse I did not feel. There's no, some people cried during depression, but there was no feeling whatsoever, no innocence. So, that is all.
So thank you very much, and I think we should first of all clap for Monica ma'am. I mean seriously, there is no other way, we have to clap. Very 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 candid and very very profound, and I think the doctor will be able to be more of an expert. And now, as Archana ma'am was saying also in the beginning, and Professor Sudhakar sir was also saying in the beginning, that obviously now it makes a lot more sense, because for me as the moderator to frame the questions and to give a gist and to address some of the things which we would want the professor to speak, I think now we have a very very good base. So thank you very much ma'am for what you have done, and so this is what this whole thing is all about. And everyone, we have had some very very good speakers in the past, who have shared their own issues. We have got them today, we have got Dr. Vikramji today, we have got Professor Lisa Pathak, and so these people have talked about their own issues, and then we all learn, and you say what
me.
Yes, of course. I was coming to you. Hang on. No one can forget you, ma'am. I was coming to you, and I was just about to say that, Archana ma'am has started this whole thing. And in fact, she was the one who said, we call it proud depressions, because there is nothing to be sad about depression as an illness. So you call it proud. So I was just coming to you, ma'am. I cannot forget you. I mean, moderator ka job bhi to milta hai na, aapse. So, okay. No, but not taking, so Archana ma'am, of course, putting this whole thing together. And I think we've got a very good team. And even our IT team, they also do a fantastic job putting these things out and, creating the attraction in the web space. Because the idea is
Sejal, we always forget to thank her.
That's why I said Sejal IT team. That's the whole thing, because the idea is to build traction and get people, say that this is nothing abnormal. And normal is actually a distribution. So, ma'am, I did not have the heart to interrupt ma'am when she was speaking about Ratlam, because I come from Madhya Pradesh and Ratlam is a very small town, like ma'am has said. Wahan kuch nahi milta except for Ratlam ka sev. Right? It's a namkeen, and you only enjoy that when you are not depressed, obviously. Otherwise, you will not be able to enjoy these things. And when you don't like a place, you don't like, but wahan kuch nahi. It's literally a one horse town. I mean, till 10 years back, that was the case. There's, you're right, the collector sits there. Other than that, nothing. And if the collector is a promotee officer, then there will be no officer your age, ma'am. I mean, as a, so, and there is no industry, there is no private enterprise, there is nothing. no movie halls, kuch bhi nahi hai. So, you know, so those are some things which I would want to address to the doctor when we are speaking, that, you know, among the causative factors, do these kind of things matter, that you are in a place wherein, you know, there is no outlet for social energy. So is that a causative factor? Ma'am has also spoken about the manic and depressive phases. So these things are very much part of the problem. So I think ma'am also now recognizes, and I think the doctor will also emphasize, that you have to manage this, and medication is lifelong. So you have to never stop medication. No, there is really no cure, it is management. But that's nothing wrong with it. I mean, thyroid, heart, we all take medication lifelong. So I think that is one more issue. So how do you manage it? Then ma'am has spoken about something that, you know, there was repeated change of doctor, change of medicine, all those things. I think identification of what medication suits you and what medication suits, that is something, you know, somebody ko lithium chal jayega, kisi ko valporic acid chalega. So those kind of things, you know, how do you manage the whole, the serotonin gang and all that? Then I leave it to the expert. And so what are the causative factors, again triggers, as ma'am mentioned, that, you know, the loss of a near and dear one, it's a very serious problem, that if you are on a medication and you want to conceive, so you have to stop medication, and then, so, because obviously while you are on medication you cannot conceive, so if you conceive you leave it, and then what happens in this, that, the bipolar coupled with the postpartum, that is a very serious way of managing it, I mean, very serious challenge. And so these are, I think, textbook examples of bipolar, not feeling like going to work, feeling judged all the time, feeling like crying, indulging in...
Parikshit, I would like to just interrupt for a little while. I would like to welcome my mom. I don't know if she come on screen, but my mom is here, Reena Varma. She's always been there. My dad was bipolar. So I would like her to share, if she is willing, about how, you know, once Dr. Sudhakar finishes, if she is willing, I would like my mom to share her story with and her relationship with my father, because mom also suffers depression, but right from childhood I've written about my father, that he was suffering from bipolar disorder, and we didn't know. He went through these manic phases where he would just be on the high, and then for years he would be just low. So mom, are you there?
आप उनको कॉल कर लीजिए, वो शायद लॉग इन करके कहीं चले गए होंगे. यू मे वांट टू जस्ट कॉल.
आई विल रिक्वेस्ट हर टू शेयर इफ शी इज विलिंग. आई डोंट नो इफ शी वुड वांट टू, बट यस, कैरी ऑन.
Yes, certainly. So, you know, these things that, you know, these are the textbook cases according to, you know, so not feeling like going to work, feeling judged, withdrawal from activities which are otherwise pleasurable. Some fellow may want to act smart, you know, and say, "Arey, wo to aise hi hai," you know. I mean, so people don't understand. So, and then otherwise pleasurable activities become a problem. Spendthrift behavior is a very serious issue, as ma'am has mentioned, you know, sometimes you just, you know, people do that, and, you know, people may want to think about indulging in self-harm. People will start writing their wills. So this kind of, this is, you know, typical behavior. And sir, so these are some questions, and believe me, bipolar is very common. There is this National Alliance on Mental Illness in the US, and they estimate that 3% of the American population, more than 10 million people, have bipolar. And AIIMS says that more than 2% Indians, and Indians don't come forward, have bipolar. So, you know, I think it's a good idea, sir. So, you know, there is so many questions for you, sir, so many things.
Sure.
And, sir, please, we'll hand it over to you, sir.
Thank you very much, Dr. Parikshit. I think at the outset, I should thank Madam Archana Varma for including me into this group. And I should also thank my friend Balaji Singh, I think he's in the group, I mean in the meeting right now, for introducing the Proud Depressives group to me, both ways. I'm very happy to really listen to some of the stories Because that gives me a sort of a patient's perspective of how they have experienced the disease. Always as professionals, we have our own viewpoint. And even if you tell something which is very relevant for you, we think clinically it's not relevant for us, why should we listen to this gibberish? So that sort of attitude I have found in many of my co-professionals. So actually my professor in All India Institute, Professor Vig, who is no more, used to tell, whether you diagnose or not, listen to the patient in toto. That is the first thing as a good psychiatrist you should learn. You should have a patient ears so that you can keep on listening to the descriptions of the patient. As you listen more and more, you will understand the patient better. And I should really congratulate Monica Ji for a beautiful narrative which she had given of the bad times which she had gone through, some of the good times where there was some damage and all that. But I will rather note down certain things which has given me some leads to talk about. Anyway, I'm not going to show you any PowerPoints as such in an educational conference. I thought it was going to be more informal. So I will rather request you to ask more questions, and in my own capacity, to whatever extent I could, I will try to answer those questions to your satisfaction. But some of the leads which Monica Ji had given me is, the most important thing is the initial denial. This is the most important thing which I found in all the patients, invariably. Whether it's uneducated, educated, sophisticated, whatever you may call, this is the uniformity which I found in most of my patients. When we say that, yes, this is a disease, this is a morbid condition which requires some sort of an intervention, maybe pharmacological intervention, maybe a non-pharmacological intervention, they will come for the consultation. But when I say that you have got a disease, they say, no, I can't have a disease. How should I have a disease? Why I should have a disease? So these sort of resistance will be there from the patients. This is one thing initially will make the professional a little bit disturbed, because for most of the questions which patients put across, we don't have definitive scientific answers. And another problem for the psychiatrist is, we do not have any investigative procedure like in other specialties where we can say by doing a particular investigation, yes, this investigation is wrong, so that means you have got a diseased body or a diseased brain. So that sort of investigations are not at our disposal right now. So this is one of our handicaps. Then she was talking about two important things. Most of the patients, whenever they suffer from either an excitement or a sadness, even their family members, they try to blame some of the ongoing stressors as a reason for this episode or for that particular condition. As a clinician, I can tell you that every one of us for that matter, we go through day in and day out with lot of stressors. I know some of my patients actually becoming depressed because one of his neighbor's dog had died. This is a very funny situation. He has nothing to do with that dog. Only on and off it used to lick his feet. That is the only attachment he had. When that dog died, this patient became depressed. Do you really believe that this could be one of the precipitating factors? Definitely no. So, really putting the blame on certain life events that is happening throughout our life as a cause for that particular episode, most of the times may turn out to be wrong. So, that's one message. And another thing very important is, she was talking about a postpartum attack. And as you all know, bipolar disorders are notorious to relapse after the childbirth or during late pregnancy. So most of the people, the bipolars, who give rise to a childbirth, usually will have a relapse of the attack even if they are on medication. But some of the mothers usually stop medication because they are afraid that they are lactating and the medicines can affect the infant. So that could be one of the reasons. And postpartum depression or postpartum psychosis as such, if it occurs in the background of bipolar disorder, we don't identify it as a separate entity. It is part of the bipolar disorder only. So we don't, maybe postpartum onset is one term which we use to specify the reason behind it. But again, it's more of a technicality rather than a norm. And then she was talking about taking medicines. I could listen from her, like there were times when she, for various reasons, could not continue taking the medication. This happens very regularly with most of the bipolar patients. So this is another thing which I'm going to discuss very shortly. And not but the least, I think I will start with the difficulty in diagnosing bipolar disorder per se. She has initially told that she had been to multiple doctors and it took a long time for them to fix up her problem as a bipolar disorder. Yes, bipolar disorder comes under a very broad spectrum of conditions which psychiatrists call as affective disorders. Of course, officially we are not supposed to follow the DSM system, that is the American system. We follow the International Classification of Diseases. We have got now the 10th version of ICD, we call it as. And we follow this system to diagnose and to communicate with other colleagues. Under this ICD-10, clinically we are supposed to use this ICD-10, but when we teach to the students, we find that DSM is a better classification than ICD-10. But I will come down to ICD-10 and let you know that under this ICD-10, there is one category exclusively for mental disorders, which we call it as capital F category. That is the chapter 5 of the ICD-10. And in this chapter 5 of the ICD, they have described right from A to G, the various conditions which follow, which has to be diagnosed with certain descriptions given in ICD-10 and with certain criteria, and that criteria had to be fulfilled. And for example, when it comes to affective disorders, which I was talking about, affective disorders are called as F30 category. So under F30 to F40, we have got various types of affective disorders. And bipolar is one of the category under this F30 to F39, overall called as affective disorders. It comes under F31 to be very precise, but it doesn't mean that the depressions cannot be in other areas. Actually, if you look at the whole International Classification of Disorders as a psychiatrist, we have got nearly 33 categories under which depression could be one of the main symptoms. But whenever we see a patient with a depression, we try to categorize, and most of the times what happens is because, as I rightly said, we don't have any investigation to prove or disprove our diagnosis. The diagnosis goes totally by your history taking, the history which patient gives in detail, and then probably some of the good observations you make and maybe a follow-up over a period of time. Even it happened to me, it took nearly sometimes 2-3 years for me to make a pakka diagnosis of bipolar disorder. So it is a very real difficult diagnosis, because you can see patients with bipolar disorders in various stages. They may be totally normal, we call them as under remission. We may see them in acute manic excitement, we may see them in a little less phase that is called as hypomania, and then we can see them in mild depressions. We can see them in severe depression where they could be potentially harmful to themselves. So it is a very big range of symptoms where you can find a patient with bipolar disorder. So most of the times it becomes very difficult for the clinician, unless he is very well versed with the patient, to make a proper diagnosis. And another important thing is there is one thing called as mixed affective disorder, which comes under bipolar only, wherein you have got patients with an established bipolar disorder, and at a particular cross section you see both manic features as well as depressive features both put together in the same patient at the same time. This actually confuses the psychiatrist also many a times, and most of the people fail to diagnose this condition. Another thing that happens during the diagnosis is one thing called as rapid cycling. Of course, this is not described in International Classification of Disorders, but this has been very well documented in DSM. In rapid cycling, the fluctuations are so fast. For 2 days, you are in a manic phase. Immediately, you switch over to very severe depression. And for 3-4 months, you are in severe depression. As you are treating depression, suddenly you jump over again to your manic phase. So it fluctuates so rapidly that either the patient or the doctor have any control over these fluctuations. And if you get at least some 4 attacks per year, then usually we say that this is a rapid cycler. And actually, rapid cycler is one of the toughest things to manage among the bipolar conditions. So these are some of the difficulties as a doctor we face. But let me all people, you know that bipolar disorders as such is a part of the so-called affective disorders. Is not rare. It's not rare. Dr. Parishit rightly said, maybe it amounts to nearly 0.5% of the population at any cross section. And the chances of even a normal person getting at least a tinge of bipolarity could be fairly at least 1% in their lifetime.
Sir, can I just interrupt for 1 minute? I think there is some background noise at Monica.
There are a lot of background noise, in fact.
Yes. Ma'am, can I just request you to mute yourself? If you'll just mute. If you can just mute, because I think there is some disturbance at your end.
It's the trains, I think, passing by.
There is a mic
icon, just tap on that, it will go mute.
Ma'am, niche, there is a... perfect, yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Now it is really clear. Yes. Thank you very much, Dr. Parishit.
My pleasure.
For making me more audible.
Please.
So, bipolar disorder is one of the toughest jobs for the psychiatrist to carry. It is, as you rightly said, in most of the patients, I don't say 100% of the patients, but in most of the patients, it is a lifelong disorder. Once you have it, it is likely that at any point of your time in future, you are going to get another attack. But usually the treatment approach when it comes to a psychiatrist, we don't tell the patient that it is better for you to take the lifelong medication. Usually my practice with my patients is that, okay, you have got this disorder, most likely it is going to run a very chronic course, but if you remain totally symptom free without getting another attack in the next 5 years, I will do some sort of an experimentation with the medication. I will try to taper off the doses to the minimum possible, or even I may give you a drug holiday. But I will give you certain important things to remember so that you can pick up the early symptoms of the disease and you can reach me before you get a full-blown attack. So this is how I usually manage, and most of the patients actually I see, some of them, they don't get a next episode even for 10 to 15 years. And when everybody had forgotten about that episode, suddenly he comes up with a fresh episode. It happens very regularly with some of the patients. But overall, as you rightly said, once you have it, it is going to be a lifelong problem. And you should be well aware of that. And you should be on the guard to make sure that the earliest symptom, whether you are on medication or even you are not on medication, to pick up and run to a doctor and report about it so that early intervention can be started. Always early interventions prevent so much of damage to the patient. Two types of damages that can occur in bipolar disorder, Monica ji has already elaborated on that. If you are in mania, everybody knows that you are behaving very abnormally and they will take all the care. But if you are in hypomania, the problem comes. Hypomanias, usually patients are well in touch with reality. Their actions appear to be very, very meaningful for any onlooker. So usually nobody bothers to really take things very seriously. And hypomanics have got an urge to plan very big, to buy too many things which are unnecessary for them. And they are just spendthrifts. They buy whatever comes to their mind. And it happens many a times that after they come out of the hypomania, they realize that they have wasted lot of money, and that actually pushes them into a sort of a guilt and depression. This happens again very regularly. So this is one danger with one extreme of the bipolar disorder. The second danger with the bipolar disorder, as all of you know, is when you go into a depression. Once you go into a depression, naturally you get lot of ideas about self-harming or even the suicide, and especially when it occurs during the postpartum, you get some sort of homicidal ideas also to kill the baby. And actually I have seen one such instance wherein I was forced to attend a court and give evidence, expert evidence as a doctor, why the mother had killed the baby by putting a few drops of lithium carbonate powdered, and she put her into the infant's mouth, and infant with high levels of lithium died. So it was an issue. So you have to be careful about these things. See, these are the two things that can happen in bipolar disorder, and the people who are suffering from it and the caregivers should be aware of these things. Once you have got an established diagnosis of bipolar disorder, It is always better that these things are identified very early before we lose control over the things, and they should be very, very promptly attended to. Then another important thing probably which a sophisticated patient, I'm talking about only not the education or other things, I'm talking about the psychological sophistication. What I mean is that I have seen lots of patients with bipolar disorder. Some of the educated people do not really give lot of thought to the symptoms which I keep telling about as very prodromal symptoms. But some of the patients who are not very literate, they are very clever. I know some of the patients, they immediately call me up, say, "Doctor, we are not getting proper sleep for the last 2 days despite taking the medicine. That too, as you rightly said, we are waking up very early in the morning, around 2 o'clock we get up, and after that we cannot go back to sleep." And we know that this is one sign of a heralding attack, maybe a depression or a hypomania or a mania. So it basically depends on psychological sophistication of the patient concerned. And as patients, I suggest everybody to develop some insights through practice so that they can pick up the symptoms very early. So early interventions always prevent damage and make things better for every one of us, the doctors, the family members, as well as the patients. I think this is one thing which I thought I should highlight in this group. And another thing which probably I should talk about without really forgetting about it is off late in the last decade or so, when every of my patient has got a smartphone, we had to utilize that technology. So usually I advise some of my bipolar patients to download some of the free apps that are available either in the app stores or in Google Pay, and try to utilize the technology, because from your memory you cannot really tell when, on which day you had a depression, on which day you had a little bit of excitement. So there are various apps that are available, and some of these apps are really good if patient really is interested in tracking his mood levels on a day-to-day basis. And this is sort of a reporter from where you can get a lot of information about what was happening to the patient between the previous visit and the present visit, how things have been moving around. So this gives us a lot of insights about the management. If somebody is interested, I can tell about some of the apps which I commonly ask my patients to download and use.
Yes, but sir, I think that will be helpful. Yes, sir, please. Yes, I think.
Should I?
Yes, yes.
Okay. One particular thing which I'm really happy with is called as Mood Log. This is one of the app very commonly I use. Then there is one more app, very simple clinical app. It is called as eMoods Bipolar Tracker. These two things are available in Google Play. So anybody having an Android phone can definitely download. And if you want some more apps which are more at a higher level, that will help you even to get some guidance through the app, whatever was stored information in the app, you have to pay a single fee. You have to subscribe for that, and that gives you not only about your mood status, it gives you some tips also, like how to handle before you reach a doctor. One such thing is probably CBT thought diary. CBT, you know, most of the depressives, they try cognitive behavioral therapy, because this is one thing which is non-pharmacological and which gives the patients lot of insights into their, especially the depressions, and they work out with that and they try to change their ideation. Cognition is basically thoughts and ideas. So it is a sort of a changing your cognitions about the external world. And by changing the cognitions, you try to control your behavior and you start feeling relieved of the depressions. So some of the mild to moderate depressions without using medication can be handled with CBT. CBT related thought diary is one such app. There is a paid version of this, and this can be very, very useful for you even to practice CBT simultaneously along with tracking of your mood. And another thing probably Monica Ji was talking about is Moody Months. This is another app which is freely available. There is a subscription also it is available. And actually this app, I use it for some of the females who has got premenstrual exacerbations of depression or premenstrual tension. Actually, this is one app which gives you some idea about their exact phases of depression, and it always correlates it with their periods, last menstrual period, so that you will know whether just before menstruation these people had a sort of a low, and you know how to handle such things once you realize that it is there. So these are some of the common apps which I use, but there are at least not less than 15 common apps which, according to the patient's convenience and your psychiatrist's choice, you can download and use this technology for bettering your lives. You need not always depend on some of the medicines, some of the people who support you. You can also download these apps and you can develop your own insights and also some sort of a direction to your doctor so that your depression can be handled better. So apart from that, I think I will rather stop my talk and then start taking questions. The important question in bipolar disorder, because it's a very chronic illness, is the compliance issue. I always give lot of importance to compliance. Most of the people with bipolar disorder, they don't continue the medication for various reasons. Unless the doctor and the patients, they talk to each other and understand the issues that are behind this non-compliance, we cannot really successfully control this condition. Some of the compliance issues are mainly related to the drug side effects. So it becomes the responsibility of the psychiatrist to strike a balance between the benefits of the drugs and between the adverse events or side effects of the drugs. Unless doctor is intelligent enough to pick up these side effects, which could be later on a reason for non-compliance, you are going to fail miserably in maintaining the compliance. One of the important compliance issues that Monica ji was talking about is when she was on medication, the daytime drowsiness. Daytime drowsiness is one of the things almost 50% to 60% of my patients stop taking the drugs. And another important thing in compliance is the people who are around the patients start saying that, see, these doctors always write medication, it is their business, whenever a patient goes, they hand over a prescription. It doesn't mean you have to take it regularly, because it ultimately denotes a sort of a weakness of your mind. So with this idea, patients think that we are psychologically strong, let us maintain that strength. So why should we depend on this medication? So they stop it. That is the second most important. It's not only the patient's concept, sometimes it is injected into the patient's mind that by taking these medications, you are going to become more and more psychologically weak and more dependent on the medication. This is a very wrong notion. If at all you want to stop the medication on this pretext, it is better for you people to discuss with your treating doctor and get everything explained properly. Of course, there are other issues that are related to compliance, like some of the issues are the psychosexual issues, where lot of things happen which makes you quite disturbed in your sexual life or in managing some of the day-to-day activities. All these things make you that the drugs are too much for me, my brain cannot tolerate all these things, so let me stop and see what happens. If you stop it on your own, always you stand exposed for another episode. So compliance is something which I give maximum importance when I am treating a bipolar patient, because it's a chronic illness and most of the patients need to take the drugs very regularly. This is another important thing. I think I have covered most of the things which I thought I should share with you. Definitely I will invite questions and try to answer the individualized problems. I'll talk most of the general things. But if there are any particular individual related issues, I'm ready to at least answer. I will try to answer.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, sir. That was a very, very informative talk. And thank you, sir. Especially, sir, I think the leverage of technology, which is something which all of us have, every Indian today can really claim that they possess a smartphone. So whether rich or poor, I think this is technology can be leveraged.
Definitely, we have to use it.
Yes, so this is something I think which is probably most of us may not have known, at least I did not know this. So, normally we always read and hear people saying that, you keep a diary and do this. I think more than keeping a diary, technology is much better. It is like,
it is just a 5-minute job. Every night, yes. 5-minute job, that's it.
Yes, so I think that is good. Sir, there is a question that, what would you be your advice or approach for caregivers when you are dealing with the patients, because the role of the caregiver actually becomes important. It could be near and dear ones, it could be family, friends, whatever. So what should be that approach, and what should be, how should they be dealing with the patient, and how should they be preparing themselves? That's also important.
I don't know. Thank you very much for whoever had posed this question, because this is one thing which I thought I will cover.
I think this is coming from Archana Verma, madam.
Okay.
Dr.
Thank you, madam.
So, yes, honorary doctorate.
So, actually, this is one thing which I thought I should cover, but it has just slipped out of my mind, because I thought that other things, but patients are more important. Family members, in certain areas I have already covered what is the role of the family members. See, what happens in most of the long-standing psychiatric illnesses is something we call as expressed emotions. Probably must have heard this term, I'm not very sure.
No.
These expressed emotions are the reaction of the caregivers towards the patient. How caregivers react towards the patient's behavior or thinking or the mood. And this ultimately affects the outcome of the disease. This is actually one of the important variables that can influence the outcome of the disease finally. So the caregivers, whoever are very close, should understand that they should control these expressed emotions to a very optimal level. Two types of expressed emotions, I always educate my patients' relatives, especially the spouses, and if they are unmarried, the parents, especially the mother, most of the time she takes care of these, is that two things are you should be very, very careful not to do. One is overprotection. See, what happens is once the patient becomes sick, especially in a depressed phase, the family members, especially the caregivers, tend to become overprotective. They don't allow the patient to do anything on her own. This is one extreme, like they almost like do this LIC service. Try to save, try not to get exposed for any stress and all that. This is one extreme which one should avoid. Yes, you should give a lot of importance to some of the important things in the symptomatology, but you should not shield the patient from every possible stress. Don't hide some of the important things which patient should know that is happening in the family. Suppose if there is some death in the family, we say that this patient is already depressed, and if we talk about the death, probably the symptoms will again exaggerate. But that's a wrong notion. It is better, especially when the patient is on treatment, to be more, transparent in letting the patient know and go through the process so that it will add to her experience of going through an episode. So this is one extreme expressed emotion which people should avoid. The second expressed emotion which people should avoid is the other extreme, wherein you become so critical about the patient. Whatever patient does, you see it with a convex lens. You start advising the patient, you are doing this, that shows that you are abnormal, you should not have done this, you should not be doing this again. So for everything patient does in her routine life, you become very intrusive into her life and start criticizing her or advising her or passing judgments on her behavior. This is another extreme. Both these extremes should be avoided. How you strike a balance is very specific to that given family and the relationship between the patient and the caregiver. So I'm not going to say what is right or wrong for a given situation, but these are the two extremes to express the emotions which you should not at least show towards the patient. The other things I've already covered, like the caregiver should be vigilant enough to notice subtle changes in the sleep, especially early morning awakening, which is a hallmark of a heralding episode. And then another thing which they should notice is, again, very subtle symptoms which they should pick up early if patient is not able to do that and bring it to the notice of the doctor. For example, as I said, a little bit of irritability, a little bit of spendthriftness, then a little bit of social withdrawal, a little bit of loss of appetite, a little bit of disinterest in routine activities like watching a TV, or a patient stops smiling at when you crack a joke. These are all very subtle things which can be picked up by very close relatives, and these are all early signs of upcoming episode. So if you are vigilant enough to that level, it's fine. But as I said, if you go to the extremes, then it itself becomes a precipitating factor for the disease to relapse. So this is the message for the caregivers.
Thank you, sir. I mean, those are very, very subtle tips which I think can be picked up, and that is a good, very good takeaway. The other takeaway which I think you had pointed out during the course of your talk is that, you know, that drug holiday concept, and as long as the patient is keeping a very vigilant log, so then you can, and regular follow-up with the doctor and those kind of things are there. So, yes, ma'am. Ma'am, I will just come. There is a question on OCD and then there is a question on hypomanic. I will just come to that, or if you would want to...
You know, it's a supplementary question to caregiver thing. So, Dr. Sudhakar, you know, because I have seen my whole childhood has been spent. My mom is not willing to share. It's too painful for her. But my whole childhood has been spent in either dealing with father's manic phase or dealing with his lows and depressive phase. So, and that balancing act. And often I have seen that it's very easy for the psychiatrist to tell the caregiver, do this, do that, be for the patient. But you know, exactly. The caregiver also has a life. Hmm. And I've seen my mother's life really becoming very painful because of this constant caregiving she had to give. So how do you, what is there any advice for caregiver fatigue? Like there have been times when I just wish that, you know, Papa would just stop being manic. Or, you know, for the children also, it had a psychological impact. It made us a little bit of, you know, insecure individuals. So, because the psychiatrist always focuses on the patient, there's a lot of caregiving fatigue which, you know, the family goes through, and especially the spouse. So, you know, how do you ensure that the caregiver doesn't feel guilty if the person is not getting better despite medicine, or if the person is not medicine compliant? Because society also tends to, you know, imbue the caregiver with a lot of guilt. So is there anything in psychiatry in which you tell the patient how to deal with fatigue? Because it's a huge mental fatigue. I remember going through it as a kid.
Yeah, definitely, I fully agree with you, madam. Giving an advice is very easy. Very easy. It is free. But the problem is how to really put it into action. That is number one. You are right in that that I do give a lot of advices to my patients, relatives, that you do this, you do that, you have to be careful about this. But at the same time, by doing this, I'm putting a lot of burden on the family, indirectly making them responsible if at all there is a relapse. I mean, at least that's how the family members perceive my message. So most of the times what I do is, despite taking all these precautions, still things can go worse. You need not feel bad about it, because this is part and parcel of the disease course itself. But as far as possible, try to do or play your role properly and help me in dealing with the patient. As you rightly said, most of the times, now I realize after listening to your question, I really bother about my patient's welfare. I go by a sort of a prayer thinking that it is the responsibility of the family members, they have to go through this agony and take care of the patients. But as you rightly said, there are situations wherein the patient's relatives have broken down into patients. That happened, I mean, quite a few instances I remember, where they could not handle the patient properly, they themselves have become depressives. That happens. In that case, sometimes I do give them, especially if there is some sort of a genetic basis or some sort of a morbid symptoms that's coming up in the patient's relative, which requires some sort of a intervention, I do prescribe medication. But I also ask them to take it to improve their mental resilience. Because as you know, most of the SSRIs give some sort of a fallback support for people who are sensitive, who cannot handle stress beyond a point. Maybe in such case, what you have to do is, as I said, if there is a morbid symptomatology that is coming up in the relative, they require treatment. And maybe another thing is, if they want to really vent their emotions, I give them a separate time for listening to their story. And if they share that story with me, that itself gives them some sort of a relief. More than that, probably a psychiatrist can't do. Only thing is that, as you rightly said, I have to be watchful and I should also take care of the health of the caregiver. It not only happens with bipolar disorder or depressive patients. For that matter, it virtually happens even with dementia. I know the caregivers of dementia coming to me and saying, "Sir, when this agony is going to end, when this person may die, you tell me." I have seen even those extreme cases where the caregiver suffering is more than the suffering of the patient. So it happens in every chronic disease for that matter, especially in among the psychiatric illnesses. I do really understand your concept of really doctor taking care of the patient's relative's health. It's a really nice question. But as you giving advices are very easy, but sticking on to the advices are very, very tough. I do. But you have given me insight. Probably I'll keep it in mind. I'm already doing it to some extent. Maybe now I'm listening from a person who has suffered being a caregiver. Yes, definitely this is a sort of a insight for me. I will probably pay more attention to this. And probably I will also incorporate this as part of my teaching when I teach my postgraduates. So they will also be sensitized. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for that. And thank you, ma'am, for, a very, very important kind of thing, because many a times the relatives also, like sir was saying, end up becoming patients, or the impact is serious. In fact, many a times, I think, like you have also brought out, it might be genetic. I mean, certain things, certain traits might be genetic. You have brought out in our earlier talks. So, okay, so we will...
I will just interrupt.
Yes, sir. Please.
I have worked in North India, I have worked in South India. In South India, most of the marriages are arranged, and most of the marriages are to the maternal uncle, which doesn't happen in North India, or the immediate first cousins, uncle's daughter, or aunt's son. This sort of marriages are very, very common, especially in this part of the country. So as you rightly said, genetic factors are one of the important things which I remember. And I've seen many patients because of that genetic tinge, they tend to become patients by themselves up some time. You're right. That happens more so in South India.
Thank you. Thank you very much, sir. That is one more additional insight. So we keep learning, you know, as we go along. So that's something, yes. So, sir, we have one more question for you. Will you just speak a little bit about hypomania and the professional implications? See, because normally, as you were saying, and as ma'am has also said, you know, but this is whenever the manic episode is there, the patient is really enjoying themselves and they are, you know, they are very productive. Employers really love it that, you know, companies will be very happy that this fellow is writing great software or, you know, clearing lots of files and coming up with great proposals and all of that. And the requirement for sleep becomes very less. All those things will happen. But then when mania is there, then depression cannot be far behind. It's like sun and, you know, moon. So they cannot be far behind. So hypomania, when, you know, will you please talk about it, sir? And what are the professional implications? As in, you know, what happens to the personal, professional life of the individual?
Okay. I already talked about hypomania, how damaging it could be in some individuals. But when it comes to this manic extreme of bipolar disorder, at least in the classificatory system, we have got three grades. One is hypomania, the other is mania without psychotic features, and then mania with psychotic features. The mania with psychotic features, patients will have delusions, they will have hallucinations, they will become more and more grandiose and paranoid. So any lay person can pick up that very early and bring them to doctor. So that's not an issue at all. The other two conditions where, as you rightly said, mania without psychotic features, where patients could be very, very productive. And maybe hypomania, wherein even it is lesser than mania, but at the same time, patient is really enjoying that phase, especially in the background of the depressive episodes he had. He says, probably this is the best time in my life. I am able to enjoy and see the life as it is, as every other person enjoys. And most of the people in hypomania, they don't want any medication because they want to prolong that enjoyment for sufficient days as nature allows. So most of the people stop the medication during that phase. So in such cases, what happens is either they will jump over to the next stage, mania without psychotic features, or mania with psychotic features, and land up with admission. Or sometimes it just draws them downwards because of various activities they have undertaken during the hypomanic episode, where they can become spendthrifts. They become more generous, give away objects to everybody who are in the vicinity. So end up with losses, and that pushes them towards depression. So hypomania never lasts for more than 6 months in my experience. Maybe there are a few instances where I have seen patients continuously having hypomania even for 2 years, 3 years, where we tend to make a diagnosis which is not there in the classification as hypomanic personality, but it is not officially accepted term to use. But I have seen even such type of people, and these people are one category of the bipolars who refuse to take any treatment because they want to prolong that hypomania as long as possible. And as you rightly said, that gives them some personal euphoria which they never experienced in their life. They become more productive in some ways. Maybe in some ways they will lose more also. Most of the times they don't bother about losses. They will only look at the productivity part of it. And people around him, maybe they are happy with such a energetic person who is really forcing everybody to lot many things. So naturally, everybody enjoys it. But as I said, the danger comes when he just shifts over to the either to the other phase of mania, without psychotic features, or mania with psychotic features, or the downward trend of going into a depression for all the activities which he has undertaken. Actually, when I was a postgraduate, we among our postgraduates we used to discuss some of this. I mean, it can be taken as a joke also. If God appears in front of you and says, "See, according to your karma in your past life, prarabdha karma, we call it as, you have to have a psychiatric illness in this life. But because you have been such a good devotee of mine, I'm giving you a choice. You tell me that illness you have to suffer." Then we used to joke, if you happen to be a psychiatrist, you will choose hypomania as the disease which you want to suffer through. And one disease which I will never choose, you know what it is?
Schizophrenia
is a must apne world mein.
Achha.
They are must.
Okay.
Only relatives suffer. any other disease comes to your mind? The worst psychiatric illness one should never have. If God gives me a choice, I will say, please don't give me that disease. Anything else is okay for me. Already the question is there on that OCD.
okay. Sir, I think everybody suffers from OCD to some extent or the other. I mean,
I don't agree with that.
Okay. Don't trivialize OCD, Parikshit. It's really painful.
Ma'am, because people have been telling me that I suffer from OCD because I keep washing my hands. I keep checking
if my car is wrong. That has become a norm now in COVID period.
No, that I understand. Washing hands is a norm.
Actually, I will tell you my observation during the COVID period. Some of my OCD patients are very happy because they say everybody is doing it. Why time fall with us? We are more relaxed. So that gives them some sort of a rationality to support their symptoms.
Okay.
But this is one condition I'll tell you, OCD. The suffering is so much, and some of the thoughts which they go through, they cannot share with anybody because some of them are blasphemous thoughts, some of them are sexual thoughts, some of them are aggressive thoughts. They can't share these thoughts with any close kith and kin. They try to hide within themselves and suffer. It goes to such an extent when it exceeds their probably manageable limit, they rush to a doctor. They can't even tell it to any relative because this is something relatives can never understand. They'll simply say that, "Why are you thinking all these things? Stop thinking about it." They can't do it. They don't know how to stop it. So we are just deviating from the main topic of discussion. OCD is one condition which I think, if given a choice, I don't want to suffer from at any point of my life. I'm just
joking. Yes, please go ahead, ma'am. Please go ahead.
Okay, so my
co-member
has this
problem. You are not audible, madam. Probably, Dr. Sirohi, you can help me in getting
yes, the question. Ma'am, is it possible for you to maybe type it? Because there is some problem suddenly with your...
Okay,
so my elder brother is suffering from
depression. And he's OCD. And it was detected in during his college days. But he was in Bangalore that time, and he could take advice from him. But he has not been able to continue the medicine for long. Now he's 50 plus, and if he goes to a doctor in Patna, he don't get a good doctor working in Patna. Some of the physicians tell him, "Ki ab itna saal ab guzar gaya to, ab medicine shuru karke you will have side effects. So why bother? It seems you can handle. But he knows that he's suffering. So he's got three daughters, so lawyer is good. So he, my question is, he, can he start medicine now? If he wants to. Whether there is a good doctor and therapist or whatever, which you can suggest.
Sir, so the question is, at the age of over 50, if medication is not started, can it be started now? And of course, the follow-up is, if there is somebody that can be recommended, where this gentleman is...
I got it to some extent. Sure. You have clarified it. Thank you very much for that clarification. See, if already OCD remained untreated for such a long time, and the patient started accepting the symptoms and started living with it, and is able to cope up with the symptoms to a very great extent without feeling much distress, I will rather advise no medication, especially after the age of 50 when other comorbidities can start like diabetes or hypertension. So in such cases, probably patient can think of taking a very small dose of some of the safest medicines like SSRIs, escitalopram or fluoxamine in low doses. And once the symptoms are less, they may start practicing the other alternative non-pharmacological techniques to control their mind and improve their mental stamina. Some of these things which are very commonly employed is yoga, meditation, some of the thought-stopping techniques with the help of a clinical psychologist who is more qualified in handling these patients. Probably that may be a better choice, but initially, to even make these things happen, they may require a small dose of some of the drugs. It's a sort of a booster. It will lift them off the ground. And once they are in a comfortable zone, probably if they go for non-pharmacological techniques, probably that will give them more relief than the drugs per se. Did I answer her question properly?
Ma'am, sir, actually, she is saying that, you know, he is probably suffering from inside. That is what ma'am is trying to convey. And
what inside?
Inside, as in, so ma'am, will you just, yes.
Doctor, I'll discuss individually, I think.
Yeah, well, I think she will discuss with you offline, sir, because,
okay,
you know,
maybe.
Yeah. So, whatever, maybe because, you know, because I don't know, I mean, like Archana ma'am was saying, we tend to maybe trivialize OCD. I have been told so many times you have got OCD because you keep checking locks and
no,
you keep washing
you
your hands.
See, the difference between obsessive traits and OCD as a disease, very thin. Most of the patients who are successful, I mean, I'm not calling them as patients, they are individuals who are suffering. I'm sorry, again, I should not use that word suffering. Most of the patients, most of the individuals who have got certain habits, like you rightly said, checking things for making double sure that they are in proper way, who are more perfectionistic, who are more methodical in their approach to life. All these are called as obsessive traits. And if you are following them and if you are comfortable with them, you will never become OCD patients per se. Because two things are very important for calling a clinician, I mean for calling any patient, a patient by the clinician. One is the personal distress. You are doing it, and at the same time, you are feeling the distress. I should not be doing this, but I don't know how to control it. That is one important thing. Second thing is, patient should have some sort of a idea that whatever they are doing is beyond their control, and a little amount of magical thinking will be introduced to that. For example, if I keep my specs in this particular place, it is going to make my wife unhealthy. It's a sort of a magical thinking. You are trying to relate to totally isolated things and put an element of uncertainty to future. So that sort of suffering that again makes the patient restless, and they have to, at some stage, they have to break out them the shell and come openly saying that I can't bear it anymore and I require help. In such patients, yes, definitely we have to interfere. We have to do some intervention, maybe pharmacological, maybe non-pharmacological, whatever it is. But the people who are more perfectionistic, more methodological in their approach, that the pure souls, as I say, they need not be patients per se. They're perfect individuals for that matter. We should appreciate them.
So, thank you, sir. I think we have one question which is from Bobby Singh, madam. And what she's wanting to know is how early, as in terms of age, can symptoms be visible for any psychiatric illness? And, you know, do you see it in the teens, 20s? When do you see it? And what she has not asked, if I may add on that, when do symptoms of these diseases kind of tend to peak, or disorders tend to peak? If we can make any generalization, I know different disorders will have different, you know, ebbs and peaks, but typically what are the worst periods in terms of age in a person's life, and till when do you really, I mean, until when does this start to manifest? Which is the earliest that they manifest, sir, in your experience?
This is a very rather a big question because it encompasses all the psychiatric illnesses. Very tough to answer. But I have seen bipolar disorder developing in a 10-year-old, a 9-year-old also. There I could diagnose a bipolar disorder because one of the parents had a bipolar disorder. We go by that sort of a connection. As I said, bipolar disorder probably has got the strongest genetic associations. So maybe based on that criteria, I made a diagnosis of a bipolar disorder in 9-year-old boy. But commonly most of the bipolar disorders, in classically speaking, they develop only after the age of 20 or 30. As opposed to schizophrenic illnesses, which have got a incidence in the early ages, that is the teens, say 12 to 18 years, that is the age group, which is very, very crucial for the individual's future. That is the time where these people break down and most of them ultimately turn out to be schizophrenics. But when it comes to bipolar disorder manifests usually maybe in late 20s or early 30s. That is the common, but there are exceptions, as I said. The second thing is the types of episodes. See, most of the bipolar patients, what we observe is, in the initial stages, manic episodes are more. As age advances, as patient becomes 40 plus or 45 plus or 50 plus, the manic episodes go down and probably the depressive episodes become more frequent. So there will be a shift in the presentation. So that's what happens. The most important thing to account for this sort of a thing is that maybe some sort of a brain, what you call it as, brain constitution itself, wherein it can't handle too many stressors. As you cross 40, your responsibilities increase, your stressors in general increase, and you tend to become more and more depressed because of these responsibilities rather than becoming manic. But again, it's not a rule. It happens in most of the instances. It's not again a generalization, that's what we observe in our practice. But most important thing one should remember is, if you abuse drugs, especially alcohol, and to some extent cannabis, actually these things push the patient towards developing a psychotic illness, maybe a bipolar illness also, especially when they have a genetic background, very easily. So you have to be very, very careful with the so-called risk group, the children of the bipolars especially, or the children of people who are suffering from other affective disorders, not to especially in their teens, to go for these drugs. They start experimenting with these drugs. These drugs will ultimately culminate into a disorder. At least they will precipitate a disorder in very, very early stage. So that is the danger. And again, this is one message for the families of the affective disorder patients to be very careful about this particular issue, because they are the most vulnerable young age population who can get a disease earlier than their parents if they do all these things. So that is a caution.
So, yes, thank you, sir. I mean, those are very, very excellent insights. I think Monica, ma'am, wanted to make some interjection. No. Okay. So, sir, we will take one last question, if you permit. We have just exceeded the time.
Please.
But we will just, because we have you, we want to just, you know, abuse the facility that we have. So, I just want to take one more question, sir. How many obsessive traits is it possible that one person may have? Because before it is, categorized as a full-blown OCD. So, if you will just shed some light on it, this is coming from Mr. Devnath. And he's saying that, how many obsessive traits?
There is nothing like the number of obsessive traits, because the obsessions keep changing over a period of time. It may start with some sort of ideas related to dirt, or some pathological doubting, like you lock the door and you are not very sure.
Mm-hmm.
You switch off the light, you are not very sure. So you go back and check it one or two times and then become a little bit satisfied and come back, don't again go for it. So up to this level where it doesn't produce too much of a personal distress, the number is not important. How many obsessions are not important. If you are not feeling the distress, it's fine. If you are able to live with it. But once it starts really producing distress in you, and it starts interfering with your performance, then probably that's a sign that you are crossing the border. You require a professional help.
Fair enough. So, thank you, sir. I think it is then just about the individual figuring out that, he is distressed beyond a point. So, that I suppose is the answer to the question.
Yeah, distress is important.
Yes. So, thank you, sir. And if there are no more questions, we will just, thank the doctor once again. And we will thank our speaker also, Monica ma'am, for a very, very candid and very open kind of talk, and which, highlights... I won't even, like the doctor said, use the word patient, but a sufferer's perspective, if I may use that.
I will rather call them as clients.
Okay, whatever. So, perspective.
Parikshit, I think we should give first a big round of applause
absolutely.
To Dr. Sudhakar.
Absolutely.
I think he was just fantastic.
Absolutely. So thank you
very much
to all of
us. I should actually thank Balaji, because he has introduced me to this elite group who are personally sufferers. Actually, you have given me a lot of insights into what I do day in and day out. That's a very big information for me, take home message for me. See, this is what probably our ancestors were telling, that from everywhere you can learn something new every day. And probably you have proved that today. Thank you very much, madam, for your kindness, for including me into this group. I will look forward to participate in some other discussions in some future, maybe not immediate future, but maybe whenever there is a chance. Definitely.
Sure, sir. We will benefit from your enlightenment. And, we normally have one session every month. And
every 6 months also. Maybe.
No,
that topic pertains to me where I can be of real help.
You can always be of help on various issues which we talk about on our group. You can always be of assistance, and whenever you feel that some interventions are always welcome, sir. And for all our participants also, I think everybody does take away. I mean, you take something home from this. So I'm sure we'll be back with you next month with one more talk, and we all learn as the doctor has mentioned. So thank you very much. Thank you to...
Parikshit, please announce our next conversation. It's Nandini and Dr. Sujata have WhatsApped you.
Right. Yes, absolutely. So we are going to be having our next program on 9th. And the speaker is a student who is studying abroad, and she's a fantastic singer too, and she has suffered from depression, and so she is doing something fantastic. She is using her platform to reach to underprivileged artists, and in conversation with her will be Ms. Namrata Yadav, who is
Dr. Sujata Barkakati.
Okay, you mentioned, I'm sorry.
Namrata is the mother of Nandini.
I'm sorry. So, we're going to be having Dr. Sujata Barkakati as the speaker, and that will be on the 9th of March. So, I think we are going to be having the same time, 11 o'clock, because this, I think, suits people, so we can have maximum number of participation. Although, I think on 9th is going to be in the middle of the week or something.
Then any Sunday, 14th is a Sunday?
Yeah, ma'am, March, 14th will be Sunday. 14th
March.
That's right, 14th March. I'm sorry, I'll correct. 14th March, not 9th March. So, I just checked on the calendar. So,
it's Nandini Srivastav, and she has this, she's opened this site for the underprivileged artists. It's called Ruhania. And you visit that site, and she has, creativity is one thing which is an expression of depression. Mm-hmm. So, from her suffering, she has become an inspiration for the young talent, especially in the rural areas. So, on 14th March, we will have Nandini Srivastav in conversation with Dr. Sujata Barkakati. She is a psychiatrist in Ayur Sundra Hospital of Guwahati. She is also a very young psychiatrist. So, we thought we will take the Proud Depressive Movement to the Gen Next, because many people are demanding that come.